Have you thought about what's it going to be like eating at Christ's table in the soon coming future? Have you thought about like what that's going to be like? I mean, does it blow your mind to even think, how big is that table really going to be? Like, are we going to be able to see just down the line, all these place settings and foods, as Isaiah 25 tells us? And it's so interesting to me, the connections in the Gospels with Jesus' interactions with food. I believe Jesus loved food. Like, he was wonderful at parties. He was great in conversation and in feasting with one another. And so it's interesting to me that once again, we are involved with Jesus providing food for his people. And you might ask the question, friends, and I wouldn't knock you for this. You'd be looking at this text this morning and be like, didn't we already cover this? Fish and loaves, thousands of people? And you'd be absolutely right. We did cover this. Not just chapters and chapters ago, but literally the chapter before this one. And so what behooves us as Bible studiers is to ask the question, why in the world would Matthew bring two stories that are so like each other in such a short time span? Now, the Gospel of Mark does this, but it's a little bit more spread out, Mark 6 and Mark 8. This is looking at Mark 14 and 15. And so it draws imagery to us once again to say, if Jesus did this twice, it should mean something to us. It should draw us into thinking about what it means to be under the authority of God and trusting him for his provision and for our lives. So kind of with that in mind, I want us to take a look at not only the similarities to the same similar miracle that happened in chapter 14, but this separate miracle that's happening now in chapter 15. Let's begin in verse 29 to 31. Jesus went on from there, and he walked beside the Sea of Galilee, and he went up on the mountain, and he sat down there. And great crowds came to him, bringing with them the lame, the blind, the crippled, the mute, and many others. And they put them at his feet, and he healed them. So that the crowd wondered when they saw the mute speaking, the crippled healthy, the lame walking, and the blind seeing, that they glorified the God of Israel. Now, we're in chapter 15 of Matthew. We're a little bit ahead past the halfway point. We've been in Matthew together for almost 2 years. Can you believe that? And so the temptation is this. We read these, we account, oh, Jesus healed some people, we eat it up, and we just move on. We move on to something fresh and something new. Our proclivity towards consuming not only everything that's within our culture, but then adding it upon the word, leans us in to losing the beautiful context to what Matthew wants to say, and more predominantly what the Spirit wants to say through Matthew. And so for me as a Bible studier, and hopefully for you as a Bible studier, when you read Matthew 14 about the feeding of the 5,000, and then you turn to Matthew 15 and you're reading about the feeding of the 4,000, you got to ask the question, what's different about these two pieces? What is different about this time? Why is it that Jesus is in a different region of the Galilee than before? I want to tell it you, friends, and I know that you know this because you're faithful people of the Word, but every scripture, every word demands our attention. So what is it? This is the first question of this morning. What is it about this particular part? Well, we have to take an anchor point to the previous section of Scripture where it says in Matthew 15 that Jesus was in a Gentile region of Tyre and Sidon. He's in a place, like I mentioned last week, where he is not the norm. In fact, he is amidst pagan people who worship pagan gods, who do not know who the God of Israel is. have no connection to who Yahweh is and what he does and the relationship that he has with his chosen people. But all of a sudden, the Son of God in the flesh takes a step over the border and walks into these people's lives. And we see that most relevantly, individually, in this woman who has her daughter that is demon-possessed. And so we continue with that idea that Jesus going on from there, walking beside the Sea of Galilee, does not mean, when we see Sea of Galilee, does not mean that he's back into his common heritage and nation. No, he's still in the northeastern part of the pagan regions that are partnered, connected to the nation of Israel. And what's amazing about this to me is that all throughout the Old Testament, religious spiritual imagery that doesn't just have to happen with Yahweh, but happens with gods and spiritual beings and worshiping of them and idolatry, is that the places where foreign peoples and pagan nations worship their gods is always high places and under trees. And that alludes back to the Garden of Eden. And so there's this kind of anchor point of people connecting to, maybe I don't know Yahweh specifically, but the truth is I've been created in Yahweh's image, and therefore there's a leaning towards a particular human story that all of us are connected to. And so I believe here in verse 29, if you look very specifically, it says he went up on the mountain and sat down there. He's giving a clue to the pagan nations, the pagan people, this is where we meet God. I know where to find him. And they start coming up to this mountain where Jesus is. And there he does what no pagan idol has been able to do. He heals people. The people that have been crippled under the dominion of their pagan spiritual beings and their gods comes and finds healing with Jesus, the Son of God. These crowds then are not Jews who would be able to relate to the context of his teaching, but what they do relate to is that there's a God who's able to help me. And possibly, could it be that there's a singular God who can satisfy all of my needs? In a way, what these Gentiles are fulfilling, but they have no clue that they are fulfilling, is the prophet Isaiah. In Isaiah chapter 35, verse 3 through 8, he says this. This is one of my favorite verses. Strengthen the weak hands. Make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who have an anxious heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance. With the recompense of God, he will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap like a deer, and the tongue of the mute sing for joy. For waters break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. In the haunt of jackals where they lie down, the grass shall become reeds and rushes, and a highway shall be there, and it shall be called the way of holiness. Here's the emphasis. And the unclean shall not pass over it. It shall belong to those who walk on the way. Even if they are fools, they shall not go astray. It seems as if in some context, Isaiah 35 is being fulfilled in this narrative in Matthew. The blind, the lame, the mute, the deaf, they have trodden a path to this mountain to meet the Son of God there. Thousands and thousands, we know from this narrative, are making a line to a particular mountain where they said, I have seen God in the flesh, and he has done what no other pagan idol has been able to do. And what's interesting to me is if you look at the bottom there in verse 8 of Isaiah 35, it says, the highway shall be there. I just picture weeds being trodden down as people are walking and trailblazing this path to this mountain. But these pagan goyim, these Gentiles, are walking this way of holiness. And it's not the way of holiness because they have righteous feet, although they'll have access to that righteous feet in just a moment. It's the way of holiness because of the destination. the destination to Jesus himself. The unclean shall not pass away with it. And that's a paradoxical statement. For it is these crowds of thousands, these Gentiles, who are unclean. But this is the starting point, friends, for you, Gentile, to say, is there a possibility I can be made clean too? That I can have forgiveness of sins? Friends, do you believe that Christ can clean you? Do you believe that Christ can make you whole? That Christ can take your history and your trauma, your regret and your iniquity, and he can make you into a whole person? I believe that without a shadow of a doubt. And so often than not, it's our own fear. It's our own fear that limits us from this intimacy of meeting God where he is at and him asking you, what do you need? These verses to me, this narrative, I cannot help but see this narrative talking about the church, believers in Christ. I mean, in a way, this is so much like your testimony and like mine. I hear about who this Jesus is amongst my pagan city that I live in. And I hear that there's a rumor that he's outside of the city by this mountain, so I'm going to come and to seek him out. I find him, and he cleans me, and I've become healed. I've become a whole person in Christ Jesus through his death, burial, and his resurrection. And then others who came with me witnessed that act of cleaning and healing, and what do? Look at that, friends. They glorify the God of Israel. It's like the language of Matthew gives a clue to who they are. It's like they didn't glorify their gods when they saw their friends being healed by Jesus. They didn't say, wow, this is a work of Baal. This is a work of Ashtoreth. This is a work of Molech. No, the means by which Jesus healed them made it explicitly clear this is a God that is unlike any other God. This is the name of a God that we don't know, but we in fact can say we know where he comes from. He's the God of Israel. It's the God of the nation next door. It's the God who has no problem crossing borders to get to you. But Jesus is not finished with you yet. You Gentiles. In a way, they're sitting around and they're in awe of the living God who has healed them and made them clean. Can you imagine mute people being able to speak with joy and singing in the midst of crowds of thousands, where for the very first time they're having conversation? Man, it'd be a hard place to teach, wouldn't it? Because there's people that would be like, I've never talked before. I just want to keep on talking. Right? And it's just this joy where the lame are walking and they're just dancing around the whole area. When the deaf are like, I can hear and understand what he's saying. And he says, I've made you clean. I've healed you. You might even ask the question, well, what else is there? That's just enough, right, Jesus? Jesus says, no, what I'm also going to do is in me you will find complete and whole satisfaction. Not only will I make you whole, I'm going to make your desires whole, your wants whole. That you're going to realize after you have, in a way, tasted me, you're not going to want to go back to anything else. And when you do go back to other things, you'll realize that it's saccharine and tasteless, that it does not satisfy. And friends, this is what I believe is the lifelong work of the Christian. I truly believe this is an integral part of your and my sanctification. It's living life, having been healed and made whole by the living God, now renewing my mind and transforming me into his image by changing not only my desires, but the result of my desires. When we find complete and utter satisfaction in Christ alone, friends, we realize that nothing in this world can satisfy otherwise. And so, in a way, Jesus is giving us a picture of that. Look, verse 32 to 34. Then Jesus called his disciples to him and said, I have compassion on the crowd because they have been with me now 3 days and have nothing to eat. And I am unwilling to send them away hungry, lest they faint on the way. And the disciples said to him, where are we to get enough bread in such a desolate place to feed so great a crowd? And Jesus said to them, how many loaves do you have? And they said, 7 and a few small fish. I like what Dr. Dale Bruner says. He says, Jesus not only runs a hospital, he runs a kitchen too. And he provides for his people. And so the crowds, they see their friends and their family members healed, and they sit in awe and wonder, who is this God of Israel working through what is seemingly understood to be just this common man? And they sit there with him for how long? 3 days straight. And what's understood, alluded to, is that they're desperate enough for him to forego their hunger because they don't want to leave his presence. They just want to be where he is. And it's like, I've dropped everything. I didn't even carry my lunch bag with me. I just want to find Jesus. And we find this to be so appropriate to then the previous story of the Canaanite woman. Her faith was revealed in her desperate clinging to Jesus. And so often and not, friends, in our own culture, we believe desperate clinging to Jesus lasts about 12 hours until we decide to do something else. And the fickle nature, oftentimes, if I'm honest, the fickle nature of my heart is less resembled in the crowds there and more resembled with the disciples and their response to Jesus when he says, I have compassion and I want to provide for them. Can you just think about this for a moment? The fickleness of the disciples' view of Christ. They're hungry. They're around 4,000 men, not including women and children. And they say, Jesus, what are you going to do? Jesus just fed 5,000 a chapter ago. Chapter 14. It's just a couple of flips over. Not even. I'm right here. And you see this all throughout church history, friends, about the fickle nature of the church, so often and not, needing to be cleansed and made spotless brides before the living God, is that you see this all throughout church history. The world faces a crisis. The Lord guides, protects, provides for his church in the midst of that crisis. Then 20, 50, 100 years later, the same crisis arises and the church forgets everything that it's learned 20 years ago. And what happens to us is we become so involved with how we feel about situations, how we're exposed to situations, we become spiritual amnesiacs concerning the grace of God, his compassion, and his provision for me. If he provided for me yesterday, why would he not provide for me today? If I was healthy yesterday, why would he not love to make me healthy today? If I'm willing to simply say, instead of my health, I just want Jesus, which is what the crowd does, they find themselves provided for anyway. I think what we lack, and that is a remedy to our spiritual amnesia, is that we forget to tell stories of God's faithfulness to one another. Amen. We forget to testify of how the Lord provided for me. And I'm telling you, friends, you don't need to have some huge, amazing milestone to testify. The fact that you sucked breath yesterday is enough to say, thank you, God, that I get to suck breath today. We don't reflect on his goodness to us yesterday, so we don't have enough faith to trust him to provide for today. It seems to me, because I speak on this from personal experience, that I hate it, is that we do this spiritual amnesia in maybe one of two, or I guess both ways. Either we have forgotten how the Lord has satisfied us in the past, or we are simply not content to receive what His compassion has given us in the present. We just, oh, I'm sorry, Jesus, I don't eat fish. I don't like to eat things that are staring back at me from the plate. There's this one story from England. There is this Lord, his name was Lord Congleton. Isn't that an English name? That's crazy. Congleton. Coming downstairs one morning, Lord Congleton heard the cook exclaim, "Oh, if only I had 5 pounds, I would be content." 5 pounds mean the money back then, not she doesn't want to gain 5 pounds. "If only I had 5 pounds, wouldn't I be content?" And thinking the matter over and anxious to see the woman satisfied, he shortly after handed her a 5-pound note, at that time worth about $25. And she thanked him profusely. She said, "Thank you, thank you." And he paused outside the door to hear her if she would express her satisfaction and thank God. And as soon as his shadow was invisible, he heard her cry out, "Why didn't I say 10? And I hate to think that I resonate with that. That I'm still willing to say thank you. Whoa. Thank you. I'm still willing to sit. You guys, I'm going to have to speak a little bit louder. Can you hear me? Yeah. Amen. I'm still willing to sit before the living God and say thank you for what's given to me, but my heart is discontent concerning just what I have been given. The grass is always greener on the other side. The psalmist says, "Hear, O my people, Psalm 81, "Hear, O my people, while I admonish you." You ready for that? Does that sound good? "O Israel, if you would but listen to me, there shall be no strange god among you. You shall not bow down to a foreign god. I am the Lord your God who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. Open your mouth wide, and I will fill it. But my people did not listen to my voice. Israel would not submit to me. So I gave them over to their stubborn hearts to follow their own counsels. Oh, that my people would listen to me, that Israel would walk in my ways. I would soon subdue their enemies and turn my hand against their foes. Those who hate the Lord would cringe towards them, and their fate would last forever. Oh, but I would feed you. I would feed you with the finest of the wheat and with honey from the rock. I would satisfy you." We receive honey from the rock, and we are audacious enough to say to God, "Thank you, Lord, that takes me to about 70%. And I'm going to use my own ambition, my own hustle to get me to the 30%, and then I'll be content." And we're never content. So Jesus says to them, "How many loaves do you have?" And they said, 7 and a few small fish. And directing the crowd to sit down on the ground, he took the 7 loaves and the fish, and having given thanks, he broke them, and he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds. And they all ate, and they were satisfied. And they took up 7 baskets full of the broken pieces left over. Those who ate were 4,000 men, besides women and children. And after sending away the crowds, he got into the boat and went to the region of Magadan. I like this when he says that they all ate and were satisfied, meaning the disciples ate too. We have two contrasting attitudes. We have stinky Gentiles that have been healed for the first time ever in their existence by Yahweh, as far as they understand, and they said, "We would rather die of hunger than to walk away from the presence of God." And then we have the disciples that have been inundated with God's blessing. And they're like, "Ugh, fish again? Bread again?" And I love this because God, in his compassion and his mercy, still feeds that discontent heart. Still feeds that heart that is unwilling to say, I just want you, Jesus. I just want you. That word satisfaction in the Greek is ekortahastaton. And it means the using for the fattening of cattle. It means they didn't just have a Costco sample. They had all that they wanted. If you wanted to keep eating, keep eating. If you wanted to keep having bread, you could keep having bread. Can you imagine the children being there saying, Mommy, is there any more fish? And she's able to say yes over and over and over again. Have you ever been in a place like that where you were just so inundated with blessing that it actually causes you to quake in fear rather than for you to jump for joy because you realize, I don't deserve this. I don't deserve this blessing. That Greek word, I'm not going to say it again because I'd mess it up. That same word is used in the previous chapter, in chapter 14, when it was the Jews who were satisfied with the bread and the fish. What I believe Jesus is saying is that there's the church that's coming, as I showed you guys last week. There's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, but Christ is in all. And the discovery of this, friends, is that the same meal is afforded access to every single human being on this planet. But you make the decision whether you're going to sit down at his table and receive his blessing. We receive that same opportunity. And so, maybe we need to ask a question as we come in conclusion to this sermon. It's a simple one. Lord, I want to be satisfied in you. How do I find satisfaction in you, right? I want to be satisfied in you. Look at my heart. This is what I want. How do I do it? I think if we take this narrative and make it an application for us, we'll get into a pretty close spot concerning how to find satisfaction in the Lord. And it's number one, this. Know that your satisfaction begins first with God's compassion towards you. Okay? God's compassion towards you, no matter what position you are in, his compassion is what draws us to repentance, right? It's his compassion that is not only the source by which we receive blessing, but also the access to repentance. In a way, it should make us jump for joy, and it should make us quake in fear at the same time. Because I don't deserve this compassion. There's never been a moment where I've deserved this compassion. Yet, he overwhelms us with his compassion. And therefore, if I can know, okay, I know where to find satisfaction, and that's in the love of God, then I'm at a great start to my sanctification. To say it begins with him and not me, friends, that's a way high jump against what the world thinks. James, the brother of Jesus, he says this. He says, do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good gift, every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. This tells me that my satisfaction comes from a compassionate God who does not change, and in which every gift that I've ever received in my existence of 40 years comes from him. And therefore, my blessing does not begin with my hustle. My blessing does not begin with my ambition. My blessing begins with the fact that I've been created in the image of God, and he draws me into relationship and intimacy with him. And once I call him Father, then I know I have everything that I need. Amen. Secondly, if you have a need that you believe is essential for your satisfaction in Jesus, he's just willing enough to sit down with you and listen to it. So make known the need and sit with Jesus, just like these Gentiles did. And even if it's necessary, you have a friend that has a dear need, you walk with him or her to that place where Jesus is, and you sit down with Jesus and say, before the living God in prayer and supplication, we make our request made known before you, God. We have a desperate need. Would you fill it? And so often and not, the Lord either provides for us or he doesn't provide for us in that particular way. And I have to tell you, I testify before you, the things that God has not provided for me and which I thought I needed is a blessing in disguise. It's a blessing in disguise. St. John of the Cross, who I don't agree with everything that he said as a church father, but he had this thing that he called holy indifference. Holy indifference. And it says, what is necessary for me to be content with God to the point that I'm facing a desperate situation of one of two outcomes, and I can say before the living God, as long as I have you, I don't care which outcome comes into play. That's what holy indifference is. I can have it, or I cannot have it. My satisfaction is right here. Just simply being in the presence of the living God. Thirdly, testify of God's goodness in the past so you do not become a spiritual amnesiac. Maybe it's because you are so hungry for a blessing that you are blind to the fact of what God has already given you. And so no matter which outcome comes into play, my relationship as son to the Father is simple thankfulness of my own existence, my own provision, the protection that God has given me over my family and my household. And I know that I can easily forget. I know the fickleness of my brain and my heart. And lastly, friends, desperate clinging to Jesus will provide provision. Desperate clinging to Jesus will provide provision. I want to counteract this with a verse that is often used and abused. And I'm not seeking to insult anybody, but I am seeking to bring clarity to Scripture. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Amen? Amen, right? When I say this verse is abused, I say it's abused because when we read that verse, my singular focus is, I can do all things. It's almost as if that's capitalized and lowercase is through him who strengthens me. When those are two sides of the coin where the dominant phrase is through him who strengthens me. Therefore, my strength originates in my relationship of compassion that God has for me to begin with. And it doesn't necessarily mean I can score 12 touchdowns in a football game because I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But it can be like David where he says, I can come against 1,000. I can climb a wall against a troop like nothing. As long as the Lord is for me and I'm submissive to God's orchestration, then I am guaranteed a provision. But just as Psalm 81 told us, you shall have no strange God among you. You shall not bow down to a foreign God. It might be necessary for us, friends, when we have a need in order to provide, that there's a demand of repentance to be able to proclaim Psalm 139. Lord, would you search me and would you know me? Would you see any wicked thing within me and would you remove it? In order for me to either know what you have in store for me or simply be content and say thank you anyways. So as a closing, let me just read Philippians chapter 4, verse 10 and 13, because I think this is what encapsulates in the words of Paul what satisfaction in God is this. I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound in any and every circumstance. I've learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Let's pray together, shall we? As the worship team comes up, I want to provide an opportunity for confession this morning. Let's focus on confession. Let's close our eyes before the living God. The same compassion that is the origin of your provision, of your life, is also the same compassion that provides for your forgiveness. So he offers his compassion to you right here and now. That maybe at home you've been having conversations just like this with your spouse, saying, man, I feel like we just can't get ahead. We expected that tax return, it didn't come. I'm in this particular place of discontentment. Even the simple statement, I just hunger for the living God. I'm just hungry for him. Let me just take a moment of silence where you can speak in your language to the Lord and offer up confession before him and then thankfulness for what he's provided. Okay, let's do that now.